So, number one, you have a book called G.B. Mahapatra. Then you have a book called Praveen Singh. So this, a little bit of this will be important. Number three, you will have a book called Bhangad. So these three books should be more than sufficient to cover these particular topics for the test, or these particular topics that are given in this particular lecture that we are going to start just now. So the first thing that we are going to discuss is the origin of the solar system. So for the origin of the solar system, there were many theories that have been given. So we'll discuss all of these theories one by one. So the first group of theories is known as uniparental theories. And the second group is known as biparental theories. So uniparental theories, these are those theories which say that only one body was there from which the sun and the rest of the solar system have originated. And biparental theories, they mean that there were multiple bodies from which such planets have been isolated. So the first type of theory that is given, it's known as the nebular hypothesis. Nebular hypothesis was given by two scientists, Kant and Laplace, right? So Kant and Laplace, they gave the nebular hypothesis, and they gave it in the year 1796. So in the year 1796, Kant and Laplace, they gave the nebular hypothesis. So according to this hypothesis, the solar system was a part of a single large flat rotating nebula. So now here first you have to understand that what is this term nebula. So nebula is basic. Nebula, what it means is that it is a cloud of hot gases and dust, right? So various matter objects and hot gases. So it is a result of cloud of hot gases and dust. That is what a nebula is. So this, all of the contents of the solar system, they were present in single large flat rotating nebula according to this nebular hypothesis. So how they separated? So what happened, that because of the force of gravitation, the Wharf clock method. Now what is this Wharf clock method? So various Wharf clock method is when sedimentary deposits, they are of glacial origin, they represent annual accumulation of layers. So we can count these layers, and with that layer we can calculate the age of the earth. Now this is obviously not a very correct method. So in this, the age of the earth is only 10,000 years. So we have seen age from 0 to 10,000. So this is obviously not 100% correct. Second, you have the sedimentation. In this, we discuss what is the annual rate. These are all indirect methods. So you have the sedimentation method or the sedimentation clock. In this, what you have is that the average rate of deposit is calculated of the sediments, and then you calculate the thickness of the sediments, and then you will know the age, right? So here what happens is, it is accepted that on an average, you have 1 foot of deposit in 755 years. Right. So with this, the age of the earth comes to around 510 million years. Right. Next, you have the salinity clock. So in this, what you do is you check the salinity. You see how much of the salt is added per annum to the sea. Then you see the present salinity of the sea. So what will happen? You will come to know in how many years that much of salt has deposited. Right. Then rate of cooling of earth, you see what is the present temperature of the earth, you know what is the last previous temperature, you see how much temperature drops per annum, and with that you are able to calculate the age of the earth. But please remember, these methods are really, really not that quick. Another one that is even more vague is known as the evolutionary method. You see in how many years new species is formed, and you see how many new species are formed, and how long it takes for evolution to happen. And with that, you indirectly try to calculate the age of the earth. But these methods, please remember that they are not very, very they are not very very sure. Okay, they are not very very clear. See, because Warp clock would mean 0 to 10,000 years. We all know that is not the age of the Earth. So with the radioactive methods, we have been able to calculate the age of the Earth, and that is 4.6 billion years ago. So the universe formed 14 billion years ago. The sun formed some 10 billion years ago. So sorry, the sun formed some 5 billion years ago, and Earth formed some 4.6 billion years ago. So with this, I will like to end the very basic general geology lecture, in which we have talked about the universe and the solar system. Thank you. Earthquakes. Or let's say seismicity. Right? So now the first thing that we are going to do is, what is an earthquake? So earthquake is, number one, a sudden vibration. A sudden vibration in the on the surface of the earth, that is known as an earthquake. Right? Now how does this originate? How does this earthquake it originate? So for this, what we have to understand is that in the earth there are many faults. Now what are these faults? So faults are basically zones on the earth along which the movement is possible. Now if a movement is possible around certain zones and earth moves along that zone, there will be sudden release of vibrations and sudden release of energy. This release of energy and vibration will be called as an earthquake. Now what happens is, suppose there are two zones on the earth, right? One is here, one is here. There is a fault between the two parts. Now this fault, it wants to make a movement happen. This block one wants to go up and block two wants to come down. But what happens is, there is a lot of overlying material. There is friction. So this does not happen, right? So what happens is that there is a buildup of energy. This fault line, there is supposed to be movement. It is trying to build up enough energy so that this block slides up or this block slides this way, right? Now what happens is that these blocks, they are constantly trying to keep up energy, and the potential energy keeps getting stored. So now what happens is, all of a sudden, when they are able to muster enough energy for this movement, what will happen? All of that potential energy is released, and when all of that potential energy is released, what happens? Earthquake vibrations are also released. This is also known as the elastic rebound theory, right? So now it is the elastic rebound theory. It is basically, if you take a elastic rubber band, if you take and you keep stretching the elastic rubber band, then what will happen? The moment you leave the rubber band, it is going to jump. Why? Because when you are stretching the elastic rubber band, at that point in time, you are storing potential energy. The moment you leave it, all of that energy is released. So something like that happens. So one example that is given is that if you take a stick, then what will happen? If you keep bending it, what you are doing when you're bending it? You are storing potential energy. Once it breaks, what happens? When it will break, the two ends of the stick, they're going to vibrate like this. So what happens is, when you bend, this energy is stored, and when it breaks, it starts vibrating, right? So that is the elastic rebound theory. So elastic rebound theory gives sort of explanation as to why earthquakes happen. So release of an energy that occurs along a fault, that is the reason for the earthquakes. Now the point beneath, so this is the earth's crust, right? The surface of the earth. Now beneath the point where this energy is released, that point is called the focus or hypocenter, right? And the point which is vertically above this hypocenter or the focus, that point is known as the epicenter. So epicenter is the point on the surface. Please remember, epicenter will always be on the surface. It will be the focus which will be at a certain depth. Okay, so epicenter and focus. Now, if this is the earth, let's say focus of the earthquake was here, the point which is diametrically opposite to the focus or the hypocenter is known as the anticenter, right? So point which is diametrically opposite to the hypocenter is known as the anticenter, right? Now, in the earthquake, energy is released. This energy is released in the form of waves, right? So these are your seismic waves which are released at the time of release of energy during an earthquake, right? Now, in the earthquake, there are two types of earthquake waves or seismic waves. These are known as body waves and surface waves. Body waves are the ones which travel in the interior of the earth, and surface waves are, obviously by the name it suggests, which travel on the surface. So basically, when body waves, they interact with the materials on the crust, they form surface waves. Now, surface waves are of two types, L and R, Love waves and Rayleigh waves, right? Now, body waves are of two types, primary and secondary. So, primary waves and secondary waves. Okay. Why they are called primary? Because they are first to be recorded at any earthquake recording center. So, you might have heard the term seismograph, right? So, these are the first to be recorded at the seismograph. These come later. Then come these and then come these. Right? So, body waves and secondary waves. Also, please remember, the speed of these waves will also depend on the kind of rock that they are passing through. Are they passing through a granite? Are they passing through a basalt? Are they passing through a rhyolite? So, what rock they are passing through, that will also matter in this case. Okay? Now, let's move ahead. So, for us to know about the interior of the earth, we need to study the body waves. We study the surface waves when we have to study more about the the damage that can be caused by the earthquake, right? So that is when we study the surface waves. So surface waves, how they travel is, one travels in a sinus manner like a snake, like this, right? One travels in waves up and down. It will travel and it will move the portion. So one moves the material to and fro, and one moves the material up and down, right? So that is how surface waves travel, right? Now, what is more important for us are the body waves, because they help us to know about the interior of the earth, right? So there are two types, primary waves and secondary waves. Now, primary waves, they travel like sound waves. How do sound waves travel? Through compression and refraction. So what happens, you are speaking from here, these particles vibrate, they move, they pass on the vibration to the next, then to the next, then to the next, and so on, right? So that means these can travel in solid, liquid and gases. Wherever there are particles which can be vibrated, the P waves will be able to travel there, correct? Now come the S waves. S waves, they travel like your electric waves, like this, right? So now what will happen, that in this, the movement of the particles, see this, if the direction of sound is this, then the particles are also vibrating in this direction. So here the direction of particle movement is same as the direction of wave propagation. So these are known as longitudinal waves. Here what is happening? This is the direction of energy transfer and the particles are moving up and down. So this is known as transverse wave. So if you imagine that if you tie a rope to one end of the wall and then you give a jerk on the other end, what will happen? Such waves will come. That will be like the S wave or the secondary wave. Now this cannot happen in liquids and gases. So these transfer only through solids, or we also say that they can travel through plastic materials. I will tell you why I am using the term plastic materials once we do the interior of the earth, right? So this is why primary waves and secondary waves, they are important. The most important property of these primary waves and secondary waves, which help us to study the interior of the earth, is that this primary waves, they can pass only through solid, liquids and gases, and secondary waves, they pass only through solids or plastic materials.